You're listening to the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast, a place for sex addicts to share their experiences of recovery, to help break the stigma, myths, and misconceptions of sex addiction. This podcast may contain topics of sexuality, sexual trauma, dysfunction, or other things that may be triggering. So listener discretion is advised. Hello, and welcome to the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast. My name is Jason, I'm a sex addict, and I will be your podcast host for today. Hey, what's going on, everyone? Welcome to episode number 98 of the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast. With the 4th of July this week, I haven't scheduled any new recordings for the podcast, but I did have an episode that I've been wanting to do for a while and have been saving it until there was a week where I didn't have a guest. And I wanted to focus on music, and especially around music that involves throat singing. And I use this a lot in my meditation, whether I'm listening to music like this or actually throat singing. And this is something that I've been learning to do over the past year. In the previous episode, I played a little clip of me doing that, and I hope to do a little bit more in the recording of this episode. But yeah, the focus of this one will be on music that involves throat singing. And sometimes it's called overtone singing. But I did want to read a little bit of what I found on Wikipedia. Throat singing refers to several vocal practices found in different cultures around the world. The most distinctive feature of such vocal practices is to be associated to some type of guttural voice that contrasts mostly with the common types of voices employed in singing, which are usually represented by the chest voice and the head voice, or that's also referred to as falsetto. Also, throat singing is often described as producing the sensation of more than one pitch at a time. The listener perceives two or more distinct musical notes while the singer is producing a single vocalization. Throat singing, therefore, consists of a wide range of singing techniques that originally belong to particular cultures and seem to share some sounding characteristics that make them especially noticeable by other cultures and users of mainstream singing styles. The term originates from the translation of the Tuvan/Mongolian word kume, that literally means throat or guttural. Ethnic groups from Russia, Mongolia, Japan, South Africa, Canada, Italy, China, and India, among others, accept and normally employ the term throat singing to describe their special way of producing voice and song. And a little bit further down it says, the term throat singing is obviously not precise because any singing technique involves the sound generation in the throat, the voice produced at the level of the larynx, which includes the vocal folds and other structures. And I will be talking about the vocal cords and vocal folds a little bit later in this episode. I also wanted to mention that some of the songs that I will be talking about employ a different type of bass singing called strobe bass or vocal fry, using a different technique, and it's a vibrational mode of the vocal cords that is being changed. And this technique can be used to sing a series of undertones, and there are a few songs that I want to highlight around that. But the main type of throat singing that I will be covering is kargara, where the ventricular folds, or there's a lot of different terms here, ventricular folds, very epiglottic folds or false vocal folds, vibrate along with the actual vocal cords. So among the Tuvan/Mongolian throat singing, there's the kume, which has a distinct sound with the higher overtones, and the kargara, which has the lower bass pitch tones. So I will not only be playing some world music that employs these different techniques, but also some areas in popular Western culture that have employed a lot of these types of singing techniques, whether it be samples of using Tibetan monks as a background for hip-hop, or a cappella vocal arrangements of pop music, and some of my favorite metal bands using either Kagura throat singing or the vocal fry deep bass singing. And of course, I will be talking about the music of Heilung and several of the other bands of the similar styles. I'll also be including some clips here and there from YouTube that I have found that discuss the techniques being used. I also did want to mention at the 2004 SAA International Convention, which was held in Dallas-Fort Worth, there used to be a recording called Toning and Chanting, Tools for Recovery and Unity. And our group had this on a cassette tape. And unfortunately, the recording was really, really bad. The microphones were horrible and had just an awful hiss. And I was thinking about playing a little clip of that here on this episode. There was some really cool stuff in there, but again, the audio quality is super bad. But yeah, they did create a tone together as a group, which is really awesome. And there was also another part where they talked about various vowel sounds and how that can help in personal recovery.
One of the odd starts, we'll all sing it at the same time.
I did want to start off this episode with a reading around step 11, which is sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood God, praying only for knowledge of God's will for us and the power to carry that out. And I'll be selecting a few different paragraphs and sentences from the Green Book from pages 55 through 58. So, starting off, the first and last sentences of the first paragraph. In taking the 11th step, we dedicate ourselves to an increasing spiritual awareness and a greater connection with our higher power. In step 11, we seek to improve this conscious contact so that our spiritual connection will become not only the means by which we recover from our sex addiction, but also our daily source of guidance and strength. And from the first paragraph on page 56, the two practices through which we seek to improve our spiritual connection in the step are prayer and meditation. The quality of our contact with God, the depth and riches of our spiritual life, is the goal. Prayer and meditation are the means. The forms that our prayer and meditation take will depend in large part on our personal beliefs about our higher power. We find help and guidance by asking our sponsor and other friends in recovery about their experiences in working this step. We are free to discover what works best for us. The important thing is the goal of maintaining and improving our connection to the God of our understanding. And this is from the bottom of page 57. And I may have read this on the podcast before. Some of us may practice one of the many forms of meditation intended to calm the mind. These practices can be done in a sitting position or while walking. Often, the key to this kind of meditation is concentrating on something simple, such as one's breathing. Or we may just sit quietly, turning our attention to our higher power, allowing ourselves to be open to God's grace and wisdom. There are meditation practices associated with particular traditions, and there are practices that are wholly personal and unique. No matter which method we choose, we seek to clear our minds as to become aware of God's presence and available to God's influence. So yeah, just thinking about these readings, one of the parts that I read that really stood out to me was the forms that our prayer and meditation will depend in large part on our personal beliefs about our higher power. And I've talked about this a lot on the podcast, that my higher power connects to me through music. And so the music that I'm going to be talking about in this episode really helps me in my prayer and meditation, helps me calm the mind, and connects me to something greater than myself. And so I wanted to share my personal experience with songs of a wide variety that employ this type of singing. I first became aware of throat singing while I was in college, hearing recordings of Tibetan monks doing these awesome chants, just really deep and resonant. I could not quite understand how they were making their voices so low. I thought they were just trying to talk or sing lower, and not realizing that it was a specific technique that they use to lower the pitch of their voice. So like I was mentioning earlier in the episode, that I wanted to talk about some of the studies being done around Mongolian throat singing. So there was this study of a Mongolian throat singer where they did analyze his voice with or without the throat singing. And here's what I wanted to read. It was found that the vocal folds vibrated at the same frequency throughout both modes of singing. During throat singing, the ventricular folds vibrated with complete but short closers at half the frequency of the true vocal cords, covering every second vocal fold closure. And yeah, I thought this was totally interesting. I've heard it on several YouTube analyses of this type of singing. So the exact frequency that is being sung, the vocal cords are vibrating at a certain frequency, and the false vocal cords out in front are vibrating at exactly half that speed, and it gives an awesome sound, which drops the pitch exactly one octave. So you can think of a pitch being here, and I've been using my false vocal cords for a long time doing death metal growls, and I've done that before on previous podcast episodes, but kind of a that just real gritty type of thing. So that's a voiceless noise, so there's no exact pitch to that, but if you combine the two, what it'll do is take that pitch and drop it down an octave. And so I'll try a little bit here, and I want to sing and chant along with some of the other songs that I'll be presenting in this episode. The way I've been doing it is finding a pitch and then throwing in that vibration. So back to what I was speaking about, I originally found Tibetan monks doing these really cool chants. And after hearing that, I also found it in popular music, where the Beastie Boys took that type of Tibetan monk throat chant in one of their songs called Shambhala. Fades into the song called Bodhisattva Vow. Point in their career, they were really studying Buddhism and the plight of the people in Tibet. kind of moving along in the timeline, I can remember back in 2001 when Tool was doing their tour supporting the release of their new album Lateralis, which is my favorite album of theirs. They had an opening featuring Tuvan Throat singing. And this one's got the low pitch, but it also has the high overtones, and you can hear that in this clip from a concert back in 2001. So hearing that at this show just gave me a real sense of peace, and I hadn't been really studying throat singing at that point in time. It wasn't until much, much later that I really started figuring out different types of throat singing through various pieces of music that I have. So another piece that I wanted to play comes from the banjo virtuoso Bela Fleck. And he featured some Mongolian throat singers on one of his Christmas albums. And I thought that this was really an interesting way to display throat singing and having the high whistle. Cool to hear jingle bells in that way. But yeah, I'm just learning to do those overtone type of whistles. I can't get them up very high, but it is done by the movement of the tongue on the roof of the mouth while throat singing, and it narrows down some of the other pitches that are naturally occurring, and you can change the movement of your tongue and mouth to accentuate different pitches.
You basically keep your voice low and put it into like a bit of a quack position. Because of the way the back of the tongue will bunch up and squish down in that shape, it's actually going to start to separate the note into overtones. They'll just start to separate. So you can hear those overtones appear from that tongue retraction where those overtones are starting to emerge. The flute's like,
and so several years before finding the band The Who, who I played here on the podcast, I had found a clip of a singer in Mongolia singing in the Himalayas and was absolutely just blown away by his singing. And this song here employs both the Kargara deep bass and then the other style of Tuvan throat singing, the Kume, which involves the overtones. And so I wanted to play a little bit of that here. Thank you. mentioned the band The Who. Oh my god. I've got both of their albums and a number of singles. They've done some really cool Metallica covers in Mongolian. A lot of their songs do employ both types of throat singing, the Kargara and the Hume. And so yeah, I wanted to play a little bit of the song called Black Thunder. Such a cool song. And the music for this was originally done for a Star Wars video game where the language being sung was a Star Wars language, and they re-recorded the vocals for their album in Mongolian. But yeah, I just absolutely love them. Before moving on to some of the other types of music that I've gotten into shortly after I found The Who, Vardruna, Heilung, Nabala, Ivor, Katiran, Neatland, which I will be talking about for the first time on the podcast in this episode. Before getting to those, I did want to cover a few other things. And like I mentioned, hearing a cappella groups on YouTube, man, there are some incredibly awesome videos out there, and the talent that is involved. I first became aware of bands like that through the band Pentatonix. There was an episode a while ago that I played a song from their bass singer, Avi Kaplan. And Avi does employ a lot of the low bass techniques. But one of the bands that really captured me is Voice Play. And their bass singer, Jeff Castellucci. His solo videos are absolutely amazing, and I'll be linking some of those in the show notes as well as the ones that I'm going to be playing here. The two songs that I wanted to play here on the podcast are with the a cappella group Voice Play. And again, there are so many different ones that I could play, but the first one that captured me was their version of My Mother Told Me. And I know this song primarily through the TV show Vikings. A lot of other singers and a cappella groups did various versions, whether it's on TikTok or YouTube, of this song. When Jeff Castellucci, his voice just goes down to the subharmonics, was an oh my god moment for me. It was just absolutely incredible. And this is what I wanted to talk about, strobe bass, or the vocal fry singing. And it is, instead of engaging the false vocal cords and making that rumble, it is using vocal fry, which is taking your voice down to a level like this, and it just gives a deeper type of voice. I often think of it as the noise that was produced in the horror movie The Ring. The girl coming out of the TV makes this low clicking noise. before actually playing voice play, one of Jeff Castellucci's vocal heroes was Thurl Ravenscroft, who many will know as You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch, from How the Grinch Stole Christmas cartoon. He was also the voice of Tony the Tiger and did a number of voices for Disney. But yeah, I have another Christmas song that I heard him singing, and his voice just drops, and it's absolutely amazing.
You see, the story's really true, 'cause I am Santa Claus.
So yeah, Jeff uses that type of vocal a lot more than something like Kargara. And so, yeah, this is My Mother Told Me.
My mother told me someday I will buy galley with good oars, sail to distant shores,
stand up on the prow, noble bark I steer,
steady course to the haven, hew many foemen, hew many foemen.
My mother told me someday I will bar galley with good oars,
sail to distant shores,
stand up on the prow,
noble bark I steer,
steady course to the haven, hew many foemen, hew many foemen. My mother told me someday I will buy galley.
Man, just when he goes from just that regular deep voice down to the subharmonic, oh geez. And speaking of the subharmonic, he employs that at the very beginning of this other piece that I just found, and this was called The Dragonborn Comes, and this is from the video game Skyrim, so this is really cool as well.
Claims a warrior's heart. I tell you, the dragonborn comes.
With the voice wielding power of the ancient Nordar.
Believe, the dragonborn comes.
An end to the evil of all Skyrim's foes.
Beware, beware, the dragonborn comes.
The dragonborn
comes.
For the darkness has passed and the legend yet grows.
You'll know. Dragonborns come.
Ah, super cool. Yeah, so there's just something about the vibration that does something for me that just resonates in my body. I don't use these types of pieces for meditation or anything, but it's just that low rumble that is just absolutely incredible. Thinking of some other pop culture things, the movie Dune, which came out last year, the year before, Hans Zimmer did the score for that and did not release the actual track of the Sardaukar chant from that, but I did have a clip.
Oh.
super cool. And it becomes very futuristic by doing the digital sound skips in it. But one of the things that I love that I've been able to find is an artist that has done an awesome vocal cover of this. And he's not only done one in the studio, but he's done one out in nature just to prove that he's not using any other effects on his voice, that it is his regular voice and he's just dropping it. And this is the Sardaukar chant cover. And yeah, I will be leaving that in the show notes as well. I also found people doing loops of these, and this is what I've used for meditation. Various Sardaukar chants with some other background noises. The one that I have here is about an hour and a half. I've seen one that's like maybe 3 or 4 hours. And so it's just really nice to have this nice low-pitched drone. And again, all of these are based on the Sardaukar chant from the movie Dune. So now we're back to more of the music that I've been getting into. And like I mentioned, I wanted to talk about the band Nitland, and they are from Siberia. And Natasha does the throat singing for this. So it's really interesting to hear a woman doing the Kargara type of throat singing. Yeah, I found their music through finding other artists similar to Heilung. But Natasha from Nitland and Maria Franz from Heilung did a 2-hour vocal technique video on YouTube in 2021-2022. And Natasha talks about her technique on how she does this type of throat singing. Unfortunately, the Zoom connection that she had for that video wasn't the best audio quality, and shortly thereafter she put together a 4, maybe 5-part series on different exercises you can do to work on doing this Kargara throat singing. And so I wanted to play a couple of the clips from her various exercises there, and I'll be playing clips from the 3rd and 4th videos. In the first video, she talked about making a sound like you're lifting something heavy and pulling in from the diaphragm, sort of a huh, huh, type of sound. In the second one, she talked about, she calls it snoring, an open mouth snoring sound. I've heard other people talk about it in different ways, but she talked about relaxing the throat, keeping the mouth open, and making a type of snoring sound. And so in these clips, she combines those two lessons and puts them together and continues to go on forming words that you can do.
Today we will open our throat singing sound by combining both previous exercises. As a result, you should have the first correct sound. Don't worry if the sound doesn't work on the very first day. Continue practicing and everything will definitely work out. I will show you few exercises for training your throat singing technique. The first, alternate between different vowel sounds during throat singing. The second, practice pronunciation of various words in throat singing.
Dragnar.
Keep practicing, and may the force be with you.
That last bit there was from the song Ugra, and I will be playing that in just a minute. So the band Neatland is a duo from Siberia featuring Natasha and her husband Anatoly. And Neatland is spelled NyttLand. So I selected a clip from the song which features both of them doing the throat singing, and I chose not to include the part that was just sung in the voice video. But yeah, here's the song Ugra. And the song Ritual, I really, really love this one. Yeah, that is so super cool. I also wanted to play another version of the song that they just released last year, and this one has more of a dark country feel. In fact, the song is called Dark Country Ritual. But yeah, it's with an acoustic guitar, and I wasn't quite sure how this would really fit into their style of music that they play, but I really, really dig this version. Absolutely love that. And so for me, learning how to do these various kind of vocal techniques has really stemmed from me listening to Heilung in the car and Kathiran. The Kati Ran piece that I've played on the podcast before is called Surin, which also features the members of Heilung. And this was one of the first ones that I was able to employ doing the technique along with the song. And once I was able to sing along with it, like anytime I'm hearing that in the car, I do that and it just gives this resonance in my chest. And it gives me such an amazing feeling. A lot of times I will meditate to this on my own, but when I'm in the car driving to it, when no one else is around, I will throat sing along with this one. For Heilung, one of the first ones that I learned how to do was the song Traust, and I've played that one on the podcast as well. There was one afternoon where I was humming along with the beginning. It's got kind of like a but when I sang along with the middle section, the first time that I was actually able to do it correctly, it's weird when you find that sweet spot. It not only resonates, but it amplifies. So it was so super loud, and it shocked me in the car when I hit that pitch that I was able to do that. I'm not going to record it right now, but I'm going to hopefully be able to record along with it that I can put this in post-production. I need the lyrics to be able to sing along with it. That was such an amazing discovery. And so I recorded a lot of these at night. Not the best time to be recording loud throat singing, but during both Surin and Traust, I could notice that there were certain times where I was resonating correctly and other times where my voice was falling off. So I'm not sure if you can hear that in these recordings, but anyway, I did notice it. The next song I've been wanting to talk about on the podcast for quite a while is a Heilung song off their latest album called Drift, and the song is called Busless Bahn, and I wanted to read some of the notes for the song. It says, "This is a curse. Busless Bahn is inspired by the rune spell of Busla from the Bosa saga, a legendary saga written in Iceland around the 13th century. The general translation of these inscriptions is difficult, but it is believed that it could be a protection from beings that bring damage, also taking Busla's curse into consideration, which could be some kind of spell of release, at least. In the saga, the actual rune spell that Busla knows is not mentioned. We start out singing the devastating words that are supposed to bring downfall and terror. Line by line, we change it into a blessing, like sun follows rain, and spring follows winter. It finishes with six blessing staves that celebrate the all unity and ensures the aid of the supporting spirits. Only living with the cycles of nature can give us the power to sing the evil powers of winter away come spring. The understanding that the seed has to die in order to spark vitality can bring back our joy of life in the face of death, and we can celebrate that short moment of perfect balance, for example, the equinoxes. Music and dance is the primal language of mankind. In it, we can experience the divine harmony woven through all of existence. Very, very beautiful words. So yeah, in this song, it is a call and response where Kai is reciting the lines and then the rest of the group chimes in. And that's where I chose to add my voice to that group of throat singers. At first, it starts off with all six staves being the curse. Each time they go through it, the last staff is replaced with a new line. And so by the end of the song, it has a completely different contextual meaning than the beginning. I wanted to read some of the lines that they were replacing. The literal translation is seed, branch, prosperity, gentle recovery. With that being said, here is the song Busless Bond. Either soul, either either lag, Zush, either soul, either either lag, Burn, either soul, either either lag, Mother, either soul, either either lag, Tither saddle, ast saddle, a breather, but not really the soul, either either lag, Oles, either soul, either either lag, Zush, either soul, either either lag, Kun, either soul, either either lag, Mother, either soul, either either lag, Tither saddle, ast saddle, a breather, but not either either soul, either either lag, Either soul, either either lager, Thorsch, either soul, either either lager, Kun, either soul, either either lager, Soul, saddle, ast, cella, breather, butner, Tither, saddle, ast, cella, breather, butner, Read, either soul, either either lager, Oles, either soul, either either lager, Thorsch, either soul, either either lager, Kun, either soul, either either lager, Soul, saddle, ast, cella, breather, butner, Tither, saddle, ast, cella, breather, butner, Either soul, Such a cool song, and like I said, it is a fun one to just sit there, sing back and forth with. So anyway, really, really love that one. And yeah, so one of the last pieces that I wanted to play from Heilung is the end of their song, Hockerskalder. This one is amazing when they perform it live, so it's just all of the warriors up there chanting this thing, and I've actually seen them when they landed in Singapore at the airport, the whole band got together and did the chant in the airport. It was really, really cool. But when they perform it live, Kai does this really deep, resonant thing at the very end. And in person, oh my God, is that absolutely resonant. I'm using that word a lot because, dang, that bass just flows through my body. But I've actually been able to replicate this one as well. Not as well, but, you know, I can sort of do it. I'll try it here and then I'll see if I can match the exact pitch on the track. Hari gasti unganir. Hari gasti unganir. Hari gasti uyo.
Hari gasti ungandir. Hari gasti ungandir. Hari gasti
Yeah, that is just so cool to do. Whenever I do this, I teeter on one end of it starting to hurt too much, and on the other end, my regular voice coming through. So just trying to find that sweet spot is a difficult thing. Christopher from Heilung, in a Q&A, someone asked him, how do you find that sweet spot? And he said, find the spot that doesn't hurt. And there you go. I was going to try to find that clip, but it was like a 2-hour Q&A session. So if I find it, I'll throw it in here. But it was kind of a funny thing.
Hi, I'd love to know about throat singing. How do you do that?
What does a car say when you drive a car? Like that, yeah. So that's a good starting point. So you go to win, win, you know?
Uh-huh. And from there, because I've tried to do it several times, but I tend to hurt my throat after a while.
There is a 99% chance that you will hurt your voice, so uh-huh. You have to search for that 1% where you don't. I think everyone would be able to do, but it takes a lot of practice. It's actually really good for your voice when you master it. And I think once you have it in you, it will stay with you, I think.
Is it feasible for women to achieve the throat singing
yes.
as well?
One thing I want to say about this is that in Heilung, we have both men and women in the warrior group. And all of them has the same rules. All of them can throat sing or scream or yell and be warrior-like. We are gender neutral on that matter.
But I would like to add that since I started playing as a 16-year-old with these guys throat singing, I've been trying to do it, and I can't.
But you do a mean overtone singing.
Yeah, I can overtone sing, which is easier. But it's totally doable. I hear so many cool women throat singing, so it's totally doable. But just as Christopher said, you have to find that relaxed place in your throat and just work with it, and keep working on it.
I will.
So one of the other bands that came out of Heilung, Jonas Lorentzen, who was part of the Lifa concert. He was the fourth vocalist for the band. So Maria, Kai, Christopher being the three, he would be the next one on the mic. He left and formed his own band, Nabala, and they have a really cool song, and the title trips me up, so not going to repeat it here, but I'll have the link in the show notes. And this, again, has the resonance of like a didgeridoo. And I really, really love this one. Jonas Lorentzen also went on to do some of the music for Robert Eggers' movie called The Northman. He actually acted in the movie, but he did a lot of the voices for the throat singing in that as well. The more and more that I thought about this episode, the more and more artists that I thought of including, and I wanted to mention Ivor. I've played some of her music here on the podcast, and she uses the throat singing in a completely different way for a kind of a beatboxing type of thing. And wanted to play a little clip of Itokuni, I think is how it's pronounced. Anyway, she does a lot of the same type of false vocal cord engagement. And so it's less of the kargara where it's pitched and more of just the noise. And so I wanted to play a clip of that here.
Rauben mennum djins verð
And lastly, from this type of music, I wanted to play a band called 13th Bell. And I found them through a Facebook ad. And they are native to the United States, very into Native American culture, but also Mongolian culture. And so it's an interesting mix. They only have like one or two songs out there, eagerly awaiting to hear more from them. But yeah, this one has much more of a metal feel to it, but the middle section of it goes into Mongolian throat singing, and looks like the lyrics are in Mongolian. Thinking of metal music, gonna round out this episode, getting a little bit heavy here. And the first that I wanted to play is near and dear to my heart, someone that uses the same type of resonant vocal fry technique that Jeff Castellucci uses. Peter Steele from Typo Negative has this insanely deep voice. And there were many, many songs where he's just, his voice is low, but there are a couple songs of theirs that he actually got down to an undertone, not nearly as low as Jeff Castellucci, but it's still near and dear to my heart. Peter passed away several years ago now, but he is definitely missed in the metal community still. Back to a band that I talked about with Bennett on episode 50, and I'll be talking about episode 50 here in a minute, getting to some listener feedback. But the French band Gojira, they have a couple of songs where they've used the throat singing in the background. And the song Silvera has a really cool one, and this one, again, is in the background, but I love just the way that layering this in adds more to the song. Yeah, I really love this song, and I'm not sure totally what it's about, but I love the lines that are highlighted in the chorus here. Time to open your eyes to this genocide. When you clear your mind, you see it all. You're receiving the gold of a better life. When you change yourself, you change the world. Love that. The song, The Art of Dying, has this, oh man, just the percussion alone here at the beginning is super cool. But you can start to hear layered in some throat singing that comes in. Yeah, and lastly, their song Amazonia. The song is about the burning of the Amazon forest, and they employed a lot of South American culture into it, and so getting a South American jaw harp on there. Natasha from Neatland also uses a jaw harp in a lot of their music as well. Anyway, this was really cool, and hearing the throat singing in the background as well. Absolutely love that. Great message, great song. Absolutely love Gojira. And like I mentioned, the more and more I thought about this episode, more and more songs kept popping into my head. But I've been excited to do something like this for a while, and really grateful to have the opportunity to share this with the podcast community. This type of music really helps me in my program, enabling me to focus on meditation, also engage in outer circle activity. It's just an amazing, amazing thing. So like I referenced earlier, today I actually got a few emails, but I'm going to focus on this one for this episode, and then I will read the other ones at another time. And again, I will abbreviate the name, but it says, "Hi Jason, my name is M. I'm a woman sex addict. I just joined the program in April of this year after attending a couple of NA meetings. I walked into the room of SAA and haven't stopped coming back. Even being the only woman in the group so far over these months, it's been challenging. I discovered this podcast at the beginning of my recovery. It has been an absolutely amazing tool. Work has been one of my main acting out places, and with the podcast, I've been able to redirect my thoughts and stay focused. Just listened to episode 50 with Bennett, and I gotta say, I loved it. I miss going to shows and being in mosh pits, so it was really fun to hear. I really appreciate how music has been your higher power. I've always connected deeply with music, and I enjoy how much of it's incorporated into the podcast. Keep up the life-changing work you're doing. Thanks for helping sex addicts around the world. And P.S., if some participants are open, it would be cool to be able to connect with some participants of the podcast who are struggling with similar issues. Have a great week, M." And yes, I was able to pass along her email to Bennett. and I'd be happy to forward any emails that you have to past guests of the podcast. But yeah, thank you. Thank you so much for writing in. Like I mentioned in the email that I sent, I'm working on a music-themed episode, and that is this very episode. And speaking of music, I did get another one today after I started recording. I got a really cool music playlist on Apple Music and a lot of really cool songs to digest there. So I'm going to have to go through that. There are quite a few there. But yeah, super cool. And I'll read the email on another episode. But yeah, awesome. With all of that out of the way, I'm going to be closing out this episode. And like I mentioned before, that episode number 100 is coming up. So I'm opening up the recording of that one to listeners of the podcast and past guests of the podcast to join us in a celebration. You can ask me anything about the podcast. We can do just kind of typical fellowship like we have after some of our meetings and just be there for each other, and I'll record it and see what comes. I have no specific topic for it, but it's always fun to get a group of sex addicts together and having a conversation and sharing it with the world. So I have a link for that on the BayAreaSAA.org website, and I will be leaving that in the show notes as well. And I'm preferring to leave the link for the announcement rather than the actual Zoom link on the podcast, just because it keeps another level of safety. But yeah, if you did want to leave feedback for the podcast, like the one that I just read and the others that I will be reading shortly, you can reach us at feedback@sexaddictsrecoverypod.com. And if you wanted to get a hold of me, you can reach me at jason@sexaddictsrecoverypod.com. So yeah, my voice is starting to get a little bit weary here after speaking so much and doing the throat singing as well. So anyway, I am so grateful for everyone that tuned into this episode. And as always, keep coming back. The views and opinions contained in the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of the Bay Area Intergroup or the ISO of SAA. Fala Fachini, a fria Babis.